such a big honor to be here with you today to speak about a topic that has crossed most of my career. I'm Colombian, and even though it's on the other side of the world, we're facing many similar challenges across the world, and many of our children are facing very difficult situations. My country, as many of you may have known, had an internal war that spanned for more than 50 years. And my first job was actually doing home visits in Bogota, where many families had been displaced because of this conflict. And in that experience, I met one mother, her name was Nubia, and in the first visit, she shared how many around her wanted her to relate to her child through violence. Her mother, her husband, her sisters were expecting that she would discipline her child using violence. And Nubia didn't want to do this. Her child was 7 years old, and she wanted to relate to him in a different way. And through these visits and through engaging her in experiences of play, we were able to show her different ways to engage with her child and had a really big impact on this child's life. And this made me commit my career to working with families and making sure that other mothers like Nubia also benefited from this type of experience. So I've spent the last 10 years researching parenting initiatives. And it's a great honor to now present to you the work that we're doing from the LEGO Foundation to use the power of play to promote resilience for children and families. So I shared a bit about my history and who I am. Now I want to share what the LEGO Group and the LEGO Company is about. LEGO is one of the few companies that's still owned by a family. We benefit from more than 80 years of experience and a deep commitment to improve the lives of children. The third and fourth generation still sit at the LEGO Foundation board, and they are very involved in our decisions. The foundation owns actually 25% of the LEGO Group. That's how we finance our work. The remaining 75% is owned by Kirkby, which is the family's investment fund. And they are very involved in the decisions, and they have defined as a joint mission for all of the LEGO family to inspire and develop the builders of tomorrow. Children are our role models. They learn through play. They're curious. They engage with the world with curiosity and joy. And that's the way we want to be in the world. And from the foundation, our aim has been to redefine play and reimagine learning. And why is this important? So if you do a very simple Google search of the word play, you'll see that it's defined as an activity that we do for enjoyment or recreation, but that's not serious or practical, that it doesn't have a real serious purpose. But from the foundation, we think that's very away from the truth. Play is actually very serious. It's the way in which children develop the skills that allow them to learn and to create and transform the world. And that's why, for us, success will be a future in which learning through play will empower children to become creative, engaged, lifelong learners who develop the skills to serve them, their communities, and society throughout a lifetime. So how do we do this? How do we work? This is what we call at the foundation our wheel of impact. What we do is we find programs that are doing this work of learning through play on the ground, that are doing it well, and we support them to demonstrate more results. We partner with researchers and lead academics to build and share this evidence that shows the value of learning through play, and we engage in advocacy opportunities such as this one to open minds and create more buy-in for learning through play in the world. We work with these different target audiences, and we partner with many different organizations, many of those who are here, to change the attitudes and behaviors with parents and caregivers, teachers and practitioners, working with the systems that support them, like the school system, the health system, childcare system, And we do this through governments also, because we want to reach children systemically. And more we know that we have to partner with governments. Okay. So before I go on, I want to show you a video that explains very clearly what it is that we mean by learning through play.
So the world model for what they know. Instead, reward is for what we can do with what we know. This is the new reality our children face. Life-changing technologies, jobs that haven't even been invented, and all sorts of challenges that we can't foresee. This means that what children learn and how they learn it must also change and look a lot more like the way we naturally learn, through play. But what does that look like in practice? Here are five characteristics of learning through play. Number one, actively engaging. So coming up with ideas, or just learning something new, is much more likely when you're actively engaged. Does that mean to dance or to jump around? Well, it could, but it doesn't have to. It's more about becoming so involved, so invested in what you're doing, that learning happens naturally. Like when children solve a real-world problem that matters to them. As they brainstorm and they conduct research interviews, they're immersing themselves in the subject. Or when they demonstrate the same level of involvement through creative technologies, taking a hands-on approach, building models, and getting immediate feedback when the models are tested, these children are focused, eager to explore and challenge themselves. Number two, socially interactive. We can, of course, play and learn on our own. But when we share our ideas, something happens. We get the chance to see something from another perspective, to explain things, negotiate, and then reach compromise. We learn to communicate and engage with others. Like these children. Their handicap needs more space in its tools and a peer so decided to help. They're tackling a problem that's relevant to them and people they care about. To actually design and build a solution together requires successful social interaction. This is a way for children to practice the most important skill for future jobs, well, and life in general, being able to operate in a team. Number three, iterative. Learning isn't always about being told how to do something correctly. Sometimes it takes a few mistakes to know how to progress. Keep trying and you'll get there in the end. This is textbook iterative learning. And here too, it's all about testing, changing things on the ground, and then testing again. Iteration strengthens critical thinking and reasoning. So it all leads to a deeper sense of what works and why. Number four, joyful. Learning can often take a long time, and success can seem far away. Let's be honest, it's tough to keep on enjoying. But it is a thrill to get somewhere. And as we get more involved, we chase that. Not these spurs you on, kind of like a feeling you get as you're progressing. It's also about enjoying a task for its own sake. Joy is a huge motivation to continue learning. Number five, meaningful. When a task makes sense to us and builds on what we know, when we truly care, learning becomes meaningful. These children are going to remember how they went about solving a handicap problem because it meant something to them. Learning by solving real-life problems not only benefits them as individuals, but also their families, their school, their community, and the world. When we really grasp ideas, understand how they connect, and eventually apply them in new ways. This is learning. today and tomorrow is one of challenges, but it's a tremendous opportunity. Gaining knowledge is wonderful, he said. Really, children need a deep understanding that allows them to apply their knowledge to different situations and then start new ideas. This takes practice. Let's give children a chance. Let's go on how children learn through play.
So one of the biggest messages here is that we know that learning experiences will have some of these characteristics. But regardless of where an experience falls, we know that deeper learning will happen when children can find joy and meaning, when they are actively engaged not only with their minds, but also with their hands and their hearts, where they can have the experience of experimenting and iteration, and when they have the opportunity to interact with others in these meaningful ways. The other important message is that we see that through these experiences, we're supporting holistic development. And in particular, in the early years, children are developing physically, socially, cognitively, emotionally, but they're also learning to love learning and to have this joy for continuous learning through their lives and to become creative. And that's why we think that learning through play is one of the most powerful tools that we have to transform the world. And for those of you who know the LEGO Foundation, you also know that we like to walk our talk. So I want to invite everyone now to stand up because we're going to play. I want you to shake yourself a little, shake your legs, wake up. And you'll have to have patience with me. This is the first time I'm running this activity, so we'll see how it goes. I'm going to give you these patterns. We're going to do all of them together. So let's go back. Okay. Green is for applause. Let's do it together. Orange is for snapping your fingers. Blue is for jumping. Cool. Okay. Let's see how we do it. Are you ready? Was that too easy? Let's try again. Now we're adding a level of complexity. We'll have to memorize the sequence and then repeat it when I say go. So we'll look at it, but we won't do it. Okay? Nope. I haven't said go. Go is the word, not okay. 1, 2, 3, go. Let's do it once more. No, I haven't said go. Memorize it. Okay, go. Okay, now I want you to turn to each other and talk a little bit about this experience. What happened? How did you feel? What type of skills did you use? I'll give you 30 seconds to talk to each other. Okay. Does anyone want to share what they discussed? Shouting out. It was joyful. Other words? Was it easy? No. It was not easy for me. Okay, so I'll let you into some of the insights that we have about the types of skills that we use in this very simple activity. The first one is working memory. And this is the ability to retain and manipulate distinct pieces of information over short periods of time. So first, we had to remember that green was applause, blue was jumping, orange was snapping our fingers. Then we brought out another level of complexity by memorizing the sequence. And this is an important cognitive skill that we need in our daily lives and for learning, for sure. We also required mental flexibility, which is this ability of sustaining or shifting attention depending on the demands or the rules that were given. And this is also a very important skill that children need to develop to learn fully. Self-regulation, which I think is the hardest one, which is being able to resist our impulses and what we wanted to do. At the point where it's like, you can't do it until I say go. Isn't it hard to be looking at it and trying to do it? But that requires regulating your own behavior. And through these types of experiences, and I know that I'm still getting there, we develop self-efficacy. And it's this belief in our capacity to execute behaviors that are needed to fulfill a task. And I know that every time I play this game, I feel a little frustrated and a little anxious. But the more that I do it, the more that I see that I'm getting better at it. And I start to develop this belief that I can do and the confidence that I can control my own motivation, my behavior, and my social environment. So with this very short activity, we wanted to give you a taste of what we mean by learning through play and the types of skills that we know children are developing through this. And these are very complex skills, and they begin very early on in life. So in this graph that comes from a World Bank report, we can see that the first 6 months of life are when most of the synapses are happening in the child's brain. And not only on sensory pathways or language, but these higher cognitive functions that happen in the first 5 years of life and then stabilize in adulthood. And this synapses and deformation is dependent on experience. And we know that young children spend most of their time with their parents. And that's why we say that parents and caregivers play a critical role in children's development. And it's through these playful and responsive interactions that they're laying the solid foundation for the healthy development and lifelong learning through the effect that they have on the child's brain. And to explain what we mean by this, I'm going to explain a concept from the Harvard Center of the Developing Child, which is called serve and return. I know some of you may have already heard of this concept. It comes from a metaphor in tennis where a player serves and then the other one returns. And in here, the one who's serving are babies. When a baby serves a smile or a gaze or a babble, then the adult will respond and build upon what they received, returning. And they go into this serve and return interaction that's dynamic. So I'm going to show you a short video of what it is that we mean by serve and return. Hopefully it will work. Can you help me? Okay, so in this video, we can see that the child is given something and the mother is elaborating on it. She's also interpreting how the child is feeling. She comments how before he was very angry and now he's very happy. And then she goes on to talk about whether he's hungry. And through this type of interaction, this baby is creating connections in his brain, and the brain is actually building itself. And we know that many parents don't necessarily know this. There are beliefs that children can't understand us until they're older, this type of thing, but we know that these interactions are very important. And we also know that playful interactions are a privileged context for parents to learn how to respond to their children. In an observational study where mothers were recorded in this spontaneous play when their children were 6, 13, and 26 weeks old, the researchers found that through time, the interactions became, the co-occurrence of behaviors become more frequent. So when the mother would smile, the baby would also smile. They both would laugh at the same time. They were joint gaze was happening more frequently. And of course, there's some aspect of maturation that's happening in here, but the researchers also found that in the interactions, the mothers were learning to read these gestures and the expressive repertoire of the baby and adjusting it and learning how to respond better. And so I'll show you another tiny video of what we mean by playful interactions. We could watch that the whole day. And from this, I want to note how it's not only fun, but through this type of interactions, caregivers and children are also forming a bond. And secure attachment, which is measured by the children looking for comfort or proximity in times of distress with their parents, has been connected to the way in which they can regulate high-intensity emotions during times of stress, anxiety, and illness. And there's also evidence of the relation between secure attachment and other later life outcomes, such as socio-emotional development. Children with secure attachment are more likely to show empathy and to collaborate with others. Cognitive development, they have been shown to have higher levels of attention and better school performance. And also in terms of behavior, they're less impulsive and engage in less aggressive behavior. So we know that parents play a critical role. And one of the key studies in early childhood that some of you may also know, the Jamaica Longitudinal Study divided a group of 129 children into four different conditions. A group received a nutrition package that was just milk for once a week. And the second group received home visits in which the caregivers were taught how to interact playfully with their children. A third group received both the nutrition and the cognitive stimulation, and a fourth group did not receive anything. And as you can see in the graph, they were followed for 20 years after the intervention ended. And at age 3, there were improvements in the home environment and in the quality of the interactions between the parents and the children, and some positive results on cognitive ability of the children. These were maintained until age 11, and by age 17, there were also benefits in terms of schooling. Children were 5 times more likely to be enrolled in school full-time. Socio-emotional skills, and later in life, they were less likely to be involved in crime. And by age 22, there were significant differences in earnings. The intervention group had an increase of 25% in their salaries compared to the children who didn't receive the intervention, and this was closing the gap with more advantaged peers. So this study shows that this type of home visiting programs where parent-child interactions and cognitive and social stimulation for infants and toddlers is very effective for closing the achievement gap and producing long-term economic gains. We also know that parents and caregivers benefit from this type of engagement. When children play with an adult, they benefit from understanding the constraints of the game by being challenged to being more creative and solving problems. But we are also challenged as adults when we play with children. They challenge us to develop our cognitive flexibility, to consider ideas that we wouldn't entertain otherwise. And studies have demonstrated that this can also have an effect on the stress levels of parents. In this review of child-centered play therapy, Ray found that the stress levels of parents were also reduced when they engaged in play with their children. So the evidence shows that play benefits children, it benefits parents, and we know that it's also important for children who face adversity. And here I also want to introduce the concept of toxic stress from the Harvard Center for the Developing Child. Stress is a regular part of our development. When we face an uncertain situation or something that causes anxiety, our bodies respond. Our heart rate raises, we produce stress hormones, and these responses are quite normal, and they help us to react and to adapt to new situations. The problem is when a child experiences this type of stress in a strong, frequent, and or prolonged exposure to adversity, like when they are exposed to physical or emotional abuse, neglect, when they are exposed to violence, or when they are exposed to the hardship of economic hardship of their families for a long time. And this prolonged activation of their stress response, evidence has shown, can disrupt their brain development and other organs, and it has been linked to increased diseases that are stress-related and to cognitive impairment. But I want to emphasize the second part of the definition, without adequate adult support. So the evidence shows that toxic stress can have a detrimental effect on children's development, but we also know that quality relationships can act as a buffer and as a protective factor in helping children develop coping and resilience. By coping, we mean the cognitive behavioral strategies that children employ to manage their emotions and behaviors and to adapt to a stressful and ever-changing environment. And through the use of coping and the developing of coping strategies, we eventually develop resilience, which is that capacity to cope with life and adapt to change based on the synergy between an individual and their environment. And of course, we, as a field, we have to continue committing to reducing the levels of stress that our children and families are facing. Because of this synergy of the environment, we need to work in improving the environments for our children. But at the same time, we know that many families do face this type of adverse situations, and we need to also equip individuals with the types of skills that will allow them to adapt to harmful situations. So as we've been discussing, play allows children to develop cognitive and social skills, but it also helps them manage their behavior. So we had a taste on what we mean by behavior control, but studies have shown that this also changes developmentally. So if you think back on the video that we were seeing with the blanket, there are moments in this type of interaction where the child is experiencing high intensity emotions, and through this type of interaction, they're learning how to cope and manage them, and the adults can also help them with their emotions. In another observational study, caregivers would modify the way they interacted with the child when they were experiencing anxiety by introducing physical games, by introducing rhythm, by introducing jokes. And this type of behavioral way of dealing with emotions as children develop then starts becoming more cognitive and emotional. And play provides a privileged context to do this. To give you an example, in another study, we know that for children 3 and 4 years old, it's very difficult to stay still and be quiet. But in this experiment, they asked the children to do this, just asking them. And in another condition, they asked them to do this by pretending they were a mouse, by pretending they were a very tiny, very silent, very still mouse. And they found that children were able to control their behavior more in the play condition than in the regular condition. And the theory behind this is that when children are in these roles and they take on a role, they're able to distance themselves from their emotions, their desires, their motivations, and can start to control them. And as they move and as they grow up, these roles start to become more explicit rules. And that's why children then engage in creating games with rules that they can invent themselves. And they're very good at noticing when another child breaks the rule. And they will start by controlling other people's behaviors and then internalizing this to their own emotions and behaviors. So in this review of the way in which play allows children to cope with everyday stressors, the authors say that it serves multiple interrelating adaptive functions for children, not only in building social and cognitive skills, but also helping them regulate emotions and behaviors, as well as fostering flexibility in problem solving. And these benefits extend to children in adverse situations. In the review that the Harvard Center for the Developing Child did for us on play and resilience, they cited these different studies. And to give you just one example, Fern and Howard compared the protective factors of children in different adverse situations. They looked at children who were living on the streets in cities in Colombia and in Brazil, refugee children in Lebanon, and children who had been abandoned to the state system in Romania. And they found that engagement in play allowed them to develop the types of skills that we have been discussing, but also to develop a sense of autonomy and a way to turn their actions into dialogue and to make meaning of their experiences. And engagement in play also allowed them to express their negative emotions, to release excess energy, and to make meaning of what they were going through. And the same benefits for parents have also been shown for parents in very adverse situations. We know that when a caregiver is experiencing depression, they have challenges in connecting to their children in the ways that we have seen here. A study in Pakistan where mothers were given tips on how to engage with their children for 10 weeks demonstrated that there was a reduction in depressive symptoms, and this was maintained for 6 months after the intervention ended. And another study in Australia with refugee parents demonstrated that going through play groups and meeting with other parents gave them access to a social network and emotional support. They experienced also a reduction in their stress levels at the same time that they were learning how to support their children. We also know that we need more evidence. We need to know more about what works for whom. Because even though play can benefit children in different cultural contexts, we also know that culture matters. So one of the studies that I found most powerful when I was writing my dissertation on literacy interventions was a study where they were introducing playful reading practices to Latino parents in the United States. And then they were recording the ways that the parents were interacting with the children. And they found that these interactions were actually very stressful for the parents. There was very little eye contact with their children. And there was actually a sense of relief when the activity was over. And so the intervention design group decided, well, we need to change this. Why don't we build on what the families are already doing and on their cultural practices? And they involve the families in creating family albums and comic books and the types of literature that was more familiar to them, and then they recorded them again and saw a very different type of interaction. So we can introduce new practices, we can promote new practices, but it's also important to build on what's already there and to learn more from different contexts. And in the review that the center conducted for us, only 20% of the studies, less than 20% of the studies, had been conducted in low-income, ethnically diverse, and non-Western settings. And that is why at the LEGO Foundation, we're keen on supporting the production of evidence in different contexts. And last year, we gave $100 million to the Sesame Workshop Consortium to work with the International Rescue Committee and with the NYU Global Ties Center and with BRAC to bring their experiences on humanitarian play labs in Bangladesh and to support them, also this consortium, with the crisis of Syrian refugees. This year, we're also starting an intervention with Boston College in Rwanda in the prevention of family violence. And I'm very pleased that our partners are joining us today, and we'll have a panel in which they will be able to share more of the evidence behind these interventions and more of the practices they're doing in this very different cultural context. So we know that early childhood is the basis for lifelong learning. And as a global community, we're moving from scattered efforts across systems to stronger integrated systems that support child development, that place children's development at the center. And the Nurturing Care Framework has identified the five components that we need to ensure healthy development for children and for children to thrive. We know that we need to ensure safety and health, including good health and adequate nutrition. And we also know that play can help us with three of the other components. We've seen that in opportunities for early learning, these playful interactions support children in developing skills for learning. We've seen that in responsive caregiving, the playful interactions are a privileged context for parents to learn how to respond to their kids. And in security and safety, this is a way in which secure attachment can be formed. So I want to end up by making a call for all of us to join our forces to ensure that families everywhere, and particularly families who are going through adversity, have the opportunity to play. The Minister of Finance said that he wanted to invest in interventions that work. I would say learning through play is one of those. So let's please join forces in this global movement. Thank you.